This week on Fireside Chat, we conclude our series on looking at the Flames' prospects by profiling the centermen and goaltender prospects in the system. This is Fireside Chat, episode 46. Centermen and Goaltenders, recorded April 27th, 2014.
Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
This is Dan and Matt back with you, and this week we're going to be finishing off our series on young Flames prospects. You ready, Matt?
Definitely.
So far we've talked about the defensemen, and we had our friend from the Heat Hockey headquarters come over to talk with us about the wingers in the system. We're going to focus on the centermen that are in the system, and the Flames have some interesting centermen. So since there's no current Flames news, why don't we just jump right into it?
Sounds like a plan.
First guy on our list is Matt DeBlow. He's a centerman, 20 years old. He's 6 foot, 183 pounds, U.S.-born kid who plays for the Michigan State University. I haven't followed his career all that much, but he doesn't look like, from what I've seen online, that he's all that exceptional. He's a seventh-round pick. What do you know about DeBlow?
Well, he had a really strong rookie campaign last year, and he put up 21 points at Michigan. And, you know, you'd kind of anticipate being around that again this year, but he seemed snake-bitten, and he only had a total of 4 points in 23 games, and he kind of seems to have gone off the rails a bit. I did see him in July, and I didn't even really notice him any more than any of the walk-ons. He didn't really do anything noteworthy. So, you know, it's a guy that they took in the seventh round.
Yeah, he's a seventh-round pick. He's not really expected to do a lot. And as we get through our list today, I think that we'll find that there are better centermen in the system than this kid.
Yeah, well, he was rated, like, when he was drafted to be if I recall correctly, a third-round pick, but he just fell for whatever reason. And, you know, it's one of those things when it comes to a seventh-round pick, you're pretty much throwing a dart at the board and hoping you actually hit the bullseye. Doesn't happen too often, though.
I didn't know he was ranked that high, but the fact that 30 teams passed on him from round 2 or 3 all the way down to 7 tells you that we weren't the only ones that saw some sort of flaw in his game or in his personality. I mean, that's quite a fall.
Yeah. Well, it does happen from time to time where, you know, someone won't even get drafted and you're like, how did that happen? Like, there was one player who signed with San Jose, I believe, Michael Scarbosa, who was supposed to be a second-round pick in 2010 and just didn't even get drafted. And it's like, how did that happen? So, who knows?
I don't think either of us have had a lot of time to see this guy. It's hard to find college hockey footage online, but from some of the shaky cell phone videos I've seen that people put on YouTube, he looks like he's a defensive forward. He doesn't look like he's got a lot of offensive upside. So who knows, maybe he'll be able to play that kind of role in the ECHL or even the AHL going forward. But I don't think this guy's going to be someone that we'll expect to see with the Flames.
Yeah. Honestly, I doubt that we'd even use a contract on him unless he improves greatly in the next 2 years.
With that said, though, there is one guy in the college system who I think everybody is still hoping we'll see with the Flames, and that was the 2012 first-round pick, who was picked 21st overall. The guy who surprised everybody when the Flames picked him so early, Mark Jankowski. You saw Jankowski at the rookie camp, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
And what'd you think?
Well, my opinion of him hasn't changed since I first saw him in February, the year he was drafted. February or April. It was well before he was drafted. And he has all the skills that you need in a top-flight NHL player. It's just he needs time to figure out how to use them properly. You know, like, myself, like, when I was 18, like, I grew, like, 7 inches in 1 year as well, which was pretty much what Jankowski did. And, you know, it took me a couple of years to not be tripping over my feet all the time. So I can understand why he's not been super awesome since he's been drafted. So, you know, the skill's there. It's just you gotta wait and see how he figures it out and if he does figure it out. Upcoming this next season, he should be the go-to guy on Providence. So, you know, with more responsibility, he should see his points increase significantly. And if he doesn't, then that's where the bust label might start creeping into the conversation. But, you know, it's still too early to tell.
Yeah, you were saying, you know, when you were his age, you're tripping over your feet. The thing about him is that he is growing. I don't remember exactly how much, but I know that he's grown a couple inches in the past year and a half. And I think that he's still needs to fill out that frame he has. He's currently 6'2", or he's listed 6'2", so he's still got to fill that out. But yeah, I think you're right. He has, from what I've seen, the skills to be an NHL centerman. And I think the nice thing about Jankowski is we don't need to rush him along on that path. We don't need him to be NHL ready next year or the year after or anything like that. So we can give him the time it's going to take to get accustomed to his body and let him play the game. And even if he becomes an NHL player at 23 or 24, I think we can afford that kind of time. What about you?
Yeah. Well, the thing is that if he was 2 days older than what he was, he wouldn't have even been available in 2012. He would have been a 2013 draft pick. So, you know, it, from what I saw of him at the development camp, he and Monahan were not that far apart in terms of their abilities in just raw skill, but you could see that Jankowski wasn't quite sure how to push on people and use his body effectively in protecting the puck quite yet, but the skill level was there, and if
and that's probably not so much an issue of Jankowski and his skills. That's probably the leagues they've played in. I mean, Monahan's played in the Canadian Hockey League, which is a much more up-tempo league.
Yeah, and, you know, Jankowski and Stansted College in Quebec, which, you know,
yeah, Providence that's a high College. School league. Yeah, so now he's in Providence College, which is still not a great league. So I think that's going to be part of his development, is getting him as soon as possible into a higher level league so that he can see, you know, we can see how his game rounds out there.
Yeah. I definitely think with him being 6'3", that he should be, if he develops, he should be right there with Monahan, like as a second line center. But if, and maybes, you know, it's still too early to tell exactly what they have. But, you know, it's one of those things that if he hits, then, you know, you got a big second line center who's skilled. So, you know, that's good. And at worst, you know, if we don't even bother signing him, we'll get a second round pick in, I think, 2016. So, you know, worst case scenario.
Yeah, that'd be the 21st overall pick in 2016. And that's because if you don't sign a player who drafted in the first round and you made them a decent offer, the league gives you a compensation pick.
Yeah. Or if you don't even bother signing them, you get one. Because I know Montreal had one of their picks a couple years ago where they just didn't even bother offering them.
Oh, really? You don't have to make them an offer?
No.
Okay. Yeah, so we'll see what happens with him. Again, a guy I think we have higher hopes for than DeBlow, but a guy that could go either way. I think Jankowski will probably end up having a long career in professional hockey somewhere. If he can't make the NHL, he'll probably, you know, be able to play in Europe and stuff like that for a while, but he's a guy that we'll wait and see what happens.
Yeah, and, you know, like, you look at how long it took Joel Colborn to make it into the NHL properly. He's 24, 25, and, like, he's just finally getting his feet wet. I personally think that Jankowski's a superior player from a talent perspective, but we gotta wait and see. Just be patient.
Exactly, and like I said, even if it takes him, you know, a couple extra years, I mean, even look at a guy like Giordano, who was on this team, went to Russia for a year and came back and was a better player when he came back, so maybe we see something like that even with a guy like Jankowski.
Exactly.
Lots of promise there. I think Jankowski perhaps got the short end of the stick with fans for a little bit because he was a Jay Feaster draft pick, and a lot of people didn't like the way Jay Feaster drafted more often than not. So yeah. I think there's a lot of people that perhaps have given him a negative shake right off the bat.
Well, the other thing that like a lot of people bring up is Toivu Teravainen and Olli Määttä. Well, the thing is at the time, the Flames had Berchi and Gaudreau and Granlund, who are all undersized forwards. So getting Teravainen would just exacerbate that problem a little more. And at the time, the Flames' center depth was, like, non-existent at best. So, you know, the argument between a defenseman where we did have a few players and, you know, a center where we had none, you know, we didn't have Monahan at the time or a bunch of the other guys that are on this list. So, you know, it's just one of those things that you gotta view the thought process at the time, not necessarily...
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And for those that don't know, Teravainen was another guy that was available when the Jankowski pick was made. Jankowski is rated by the Central Scouting Service as, what, 40th?
Something like that.
And we drafted him 21st, so at the time, there was a lot of disapproval among fans saying, why do we go so far off the board? I think the Flames even said at one point that they were willing to trade down to get him.
They went from 14 to 21.
Right, they did trade down, and then they talked about how they were willing to trade down further if they could have. But yeah, it was, you know, it's an odd pick, and we'll see how it turns out. But I think even if it doesn't turn out, it's not like we're, you know, missing center talent because of it.
Yeah, and at the time we had no centers, so getting a potential top six center who's 6'3", even though it might take a couple of years, I can understand that, especially with the 2012 draft, which was kind of a crappy draft.
Yeah. And to me, I think as we go through this list and we look at who's available, even if he doesn't turn out to, you know, make the NHL or even be much more than a third line guy, I think we can say, you know, we have enough centers coming up who can still fill that spot and just write it off as an interesting experiment pick. That brings us to the next guy, a guy who's been with the Heat for, I think this is his first year, Josh Juris, right-hand shooter, 23 years old, 6', 190 pounds. Juris wasn't a Flames draft pick. He was a walk-on free agent, wasn't he?
Yeah, he actually was a walk-on at the development camp back in July.
And what did you think of Juris when you saw him there?
The most direct comparable that I can equate him to is Ben Street. Someone who's got a lot of offensive skill, but not quite good enough for a top six spot in the NHL. So, like, I think he might get a cup of coffee here and there in his career, but I don't see him having the ability to bridge that gap. But yeah. That said, like, he will be a good enough scorer for the AHL where he could put up 50 or 60 points possibly down the road. He did have 27 points this year, so, you know, for a rookie that's decent, like Ben Street himself, I think had 29 or something like that in his first AHL season, and then it's been like a 50-point producer since. So,
I guess the question comes down to, yeah, he might get a cup of coffee here and there, but is he worth keeping as a contract under 50 contracts?
I think so, because the thing is that we're still going to need competent people in Abbotsford. Well, wherever Abbotsford goes after this year, but so that way when we have guys like Klimchuk and Poirier and all the next batch of forwards coming up, that they have somebody that they can play with properly. And, you know, he's very good at what he does, so there's no, you know, it's not like you're keeping some guy that's going to get you like 8 points in the AHL and not really do anything.
I've seen some Heat games during the year. I'd watch a couple of them online or, you know, listen to them on the online radio station, that sort of thing. And from the notes that I have here on my side, Juris really improved during this year. I remember seeing a game early in the year, and he didn't look like he even fit at the AHL level. And by the end of the year, he was playing very well in all three zones. He understood how to play good defensive hockey as a forward. He knew how to, you know, cycle the game out of the neutral zone. So I thought that was a really good improvement. And he also seems like he's more patient with the puck now. I remember at the beginning of the season, someone would come near him, and he'd just frantically give away the puck sometimes. And now he seems like he's a guy who has patience, will look around and see what to do with the puck. And so I think the fact that he's made those kind of strides tells you that, yeah, he probably does deserve another shot at the AHL, another year with a Flames contract, see what happens.
Yeah. And really, worst case scenario is you have somebody that can help facilitate our other guys. So, you know, it's not really a lose-lose situation there.
Yeah. Yeah, if you look at the players that we talked about in the winger episode, I mean, if you were to pair two of those guys up with Juris, you'd probably have a really nice line there, and a line that, you know, even though Juris might not, say, be the number one guy that we'd be considering for the job here, he could really help make some of those guys look really good.
Yeah, definitely.
The next center on our list comes from NHL lineage. He's got some NHL blood behind him, and that's Max Reinhardt. Drafted in round 3, 64th overall in 2010. He's 22 years old. He's been playing for the Heat for a couple of years. Reinhardt is a guy that I remember watching in Kootenay back in 2010. Not in Kootenay, but when Kootenay would come here in 2010, I think. And he had a great season, and he put up 79 points that year. I haven't seen as much as I'd like of him in the AHL, but I've always liked this guy. What are your thoughts on Reinhardt?
Well, one of the things that struck me back in the July camp was that after the scrimmages or the practices, there would be three players that would be out on the ice practicing their shooting. One was Granlund, the other was Berchi, and the third was Max Reinhardt. And he always seemed to be pushing himself to be able to improve his offensive game a bit. And last season, like, he had a rather disastrous season with only 20 points, and he was a minus 26, and, you know, was looking like kind of a bubble fourth line type at that point in time. And, you know, he put in a lot of hard work in the offseason, and it paid off for him with a near point per game pace with 63 points this season and a plus 6. So a lot has changed. And, you know, it's always good to see a positive boost in the stats, at least, because that usually means that your game's starting to come together better.
Yeah, I agree. Anytime you see a guy who looks like, not just a boost in the stats, but just a guy who looks like a boost in stats is part of it, but just a guy who looks like he's finally getting things together.
Mm-hmm.
He had 63 points this year. He was a plus 6. His first year with Abbotsford in 2012-2013, he had 21 points. He was a minus 26. So I think even that plus-minus score tells you that this guy's starting to get his game together. Mind you, he's played for a very good team this year, too, so it's probably easy to be plus, but...
Well, the thing is that, like, he hasn't been a passenger on his line. Like, I think he's been paired with Granlund most of the season. And, you know, they've both been clicking rather well. So, Reinhardt's a bit of a weird player in that his makeup, he looks like a third or fourth line guy that, you know, you see across the league. It, you know, from, like, guys like Tom Kostopoulos and, you know, the interchangeable lower depth guy.
Yeah.
But this season, with him providing so much offense, you know, he's starting to throw a little wrinkle in there to see, you know, show that he might actually have something more there than just, you know, being the fourth line defensive forward.
Well, you're saying he's, you know, you're kind of comparing him to defensive forward. One thing he's done a lot in Abbotsford this year is he's played on the special teams. He's played the power plays, played the penalty kills. He's become a really solid two-way player. So I think even if he were on this team as a third or fourth line guy, you might see a lot of him when he does make the team in that kind of a role, being a kind of special teams guy.
Yeah. Oh, I could definitely see him out there with a guy like Lance Boma killing penalties and blocking shots and, you know, doing that whole thing.
I think that even, you know, even if he doesn't have a full-time job next year, he's probably going to be one of the first call-ups anytime there's a need for a call-up, I think.
Yeah.
And I think even above a guy like Josh Juris, I think we're definitely going to see more of Max Reinhardt in a Flames jersey in the coming years.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that the Flames have three forwards that are getting long in the tooth for the AHL, and that's Reinhardt, Knight, and Hanowski. Just in terms of their age.
Reinhardt's only 22. You could keep him there for another year.
Yeah, but, you know, especially when you got guys like Poirier, our first round pick, Berchi, Granlund, you know, like, he starts getting buried. So, you know, it's more of a put up or shut up kind of thing. Like, we do need to get these guys ice time in the NHL to show the team whether or not they're worth keeping for years moving forward, or get the next guy, you know, because guys like Ferland and that are coming up as well. So, you know, we gotta see what we actually have in an NHL format, not just, oh, he's doing good in Abbotsford.
Yeah, well, and I think Reinhardt will be given every shot to prove himself at that level.
Mm-hmm.
I think it'll be up to him whether he makes the NHL or not next year, essentially out of camp.
Yeah. Like, I think it's his spot to lose,
yeah, type of thing. Yeah, I think the team likes him. I think the team's going to give him every shot they can. If you look at this list of centers that we're going through today, in my mind, he's the most NHL-ready of this group.
Yeah. Well, like, I think, like, if you took Gagliardi out and you put Reinhardt in, I don't see there being much of a difference.
No.
So, you know,
I think Reinhardt has the hockey sense, too, that if they needed to, they could convert him to a wing position as well.
Yeah, and that kind of versatility is a good thing. That's one of the things I've liked about our drafting recently, is that, like, we've got guys like Granlund, Knight, Colborne, Reinhardt, that are all centers, but you can easily shift one of them over to the wing, or multiple people over to the wing if necessary. So versatility is always a good thing.
As a top 90 player, I think this is a guy that we all expect to have some sort of, you know, pedigree and some sort of time in pro hockey. And he's definitely put in his time at the AHL level. He's played two full seasons now with the Heat. And yeah, I think that like you said, it'll be his spot to lose out of camp. And I really think that this is going to make the Flames look long and hard if they want to sign a contract with somebody like TJ Gagliardi again.
Yeah, well, you also have, like, Kevin Westgarth. His contract's coming up as well, so
I don't know that Reinhardt would be the guy who'd want to replace Westgarth in that role, but
no, of course not. But, you know, just, like, his fourth-line roster spot, not necessarily the tough guy.
Yeah.
You know, if you needed a tough guy, I think you might bring Ferland up, but
well, we also have Gratz.
Oh, yeah, I know. It's just, you know, Burke seems to like having multiple guys who can throw the fists around. Yeah, so.
And maybe, you know, you keep one of those guys as the scratched forward, and you bring a guy like Reinhardt in as the full-time guy. Well, the next guy on our list is a guy who made his NHL debut this year. He got one NHL game in, so that was kind of a... I still have mixed opinions on burning his contract for one game, but this is the, I guess, the yin to Johnny Hockey's yang, Bill Arnold from Boston College, and he had a good year. I think anyone who would play on a line with Johnny Hockey would have a good year. He played 40 games, ended up with 53 points. 14 of those were goals, 39 were assists, and he had 51 penalty minutes. He's a fourth-round pick in 2010, 108th overall, 6 foot 210. Did you get to see Billy Arnold much in the Vancouver game?
In the Vancouver game, yeah, he was noticeable, but not overly so.
I thought that he looked really jumpy at the beginning, which is to be expected.
Yeah, you could tell it was his first NHL game. In July, he and Kenny Agostino were the two interchangeable players in terms of like what they were bringing, both in terms of effort, skill level, determination, like pretty much the whole package. They was the same player, more or less. So, you know, they're both going to likely compete for third or fourth line roles moving forward. And, you know, he's a decent prospect. He's on the right trajectory for a fourth-round pick. Whether or not he takes the next steps necessary to be a full-time NHLer, who knows?
But I think, to me, the biggest question with Arnold is how well can he do if Goudreau's not playing with him?
Yeah, and, like, I think his offensive numbers are overstated because, you know,
well, I think the 14 goals tells you that. I mean, most of his points, 39 of them, were assists because he's assisting Johnny Hockey. I mean, you know, it's like when they brought Camilleri in originally or Jokinen just to pass the puck to Iggy.
Yeah. Well, like, I think there's a number of players that played with guys like Lemieux that had really inflated stats. So, you know, Gaudreau was the Lemieux of the NCAA, so, you know, it's going to skew everything.
Yeah, and that to me is the biggest question mark I have about Billy Arnold is how well is he going to do if he's not playing with Gaudreau, and is it going to make much of a difference? Is he a player that can stand on his own 2 feet?
Well, from what I've seen of him in person, he won't have, like, second-line potential, but, like, as a quality depth guy that can probably get 20 points, 30 points in a year, I could definitely see that. It's just he still has to take another step or two to get from where he is right now to that point. But, again, we have 2-3 years with him likely in the organization to figure that out.
Yeah. And I think he is going to be a longer-term prospect. I think, you know, if he does make the NHL, it'll be... I mean, he's 21 now. I think he will probably be a 24, 25-year-old when he makes the NHL, unless they're bringing him up just to put him on a line with Johnny Hockey.
Yeah, and I don't see them doing that.
No.
Because they've got so many other good offensively skilled players to put with Gaudreau.
Well, and even if you look down the center depth, I think that there's guys like Reinhardt, Granlund, who are, you know, nipping at that center spot, that last one or two center spots in the pro roster before Billy Arnold would get brought up.
Yeah, exactly.
So
it's one of those things that you just have to be patient and wait and see and all that. That's the thing with a lot of the our prospects at the moment is that they're either like still in college or they're just coming out of their first full season in the AHL. And, you know, from year to year, you don't know if a player is just going to magically take off or not. And, you know, they might have all the indications up to the point that they're at now that they're heading in that upward trajectory, but that can stagnate at any point. So
yeah, that's a good point. He is a guy who's never played pro hockey. He has one pro game under his belt, so I think he's going to need some time to adjust to the pro game. But I think the fact that Billy Arnold is a pro now, he signed a pro contract, he will definitely be playing in Abbotsford next year. So we'll get to see how he adjusts over there.
Yeah, and that's the thing with a lot of these players. Like, when we get to see them again in July, and then at the rookie tournament, and then training camp, like, we'll start to get more of a picture of what they are. Because, like, for example, like, Ryan House, when he first came to camp, he actually didn't look that bad. And then the next year, you know, yeah, no.
But I think there was some mental things going on there as well.
Oh, I know. But, you know, it's one of those things that you can't really tell until you get there. So, with any of these guys, really, the development process isn't exactly an exacting science.
Yeah. No, you're right. Next guy on our list is another centerman that I think the Flames are very eager about, very keen to watch, and a guy who did get called up here this year but got injured, and that's Marcus Granlund. I think outside of Max Reinhardt, he's the guy who's got the best shot at getting a job out of camp. What did you think of number 60 in his couple games here this year?
Well, the thing that in the offseason that I was mostly concerned about with Granlund was his foot speed. And, you know, he looked slow at all the times I had seen him in highlights prior to July, and seeing him in person, he looked a step behind. But whatever it was that happened from July forward, his foot speed has improved to the point where it's at least average. And, like, that was the main drawback with him was, well, can he overcome the fact that he's slow? Well, he's not slow anymore, so...
And, you know, that could just be playing on a good AHL team, too.
You know, like, he's got a very good shot. He's a very good passer. You know, like, his offensive game has good potential. It's just... The only concern that I had was that he was a bit slow, but that seems to have evaporated. So I'm not exactly shocked that he had 46 points in 52 games in the AHL this year and looked decent in his call-up. So, you know, it's one of those, again, you have to wait and see, but, you know, he did look like a very competent NHL player. The guy that he reminded me the most of was a young Nick Hagman.
That's an interesting comparison. Hopefully he never gets to the point where he looks like an old Nick Hagman. I think the worst thing we can do with him is to compare him to his brother, and I think a lot of people are doing that and saying, you know, he's not where Michael is and all that. Well, Michael's had a lot more pro experience. So I think we have to remember that Marcus, you know, hasn't had that pro experience yet, and he's not, I don't think... Perhaps never will be. I shouldn't say not never will be, but perhaps never will be to the same level that his brother was at. But that doesn't mean he's not a serviceable top six guy.
Well, the thing is that statistically, he actually wasn't that far off of where his brother was in any of his seasons. So, you know, because, like, Granlund came over the year after he was drafted and all that, and, like, statistically, him and his brother are just a few points apart. So, like, they do play a significantly different style of game, with his older brother being more of a passer where he's more of a shooter. You know, like, they don't play the same style of game even, but the points seem to be there, so...
I think his brother's benefited a lot in his career from playing with good players on his line. He wasn't coming through, say, a rebuilding team. So I think, you know, he got to play with some very good players in Minnesota, and I think that, you know, changes how people think of him too.
And, you know, they're both very skilled. His brother is more skilled than he is, but it's not, like, by orders of magnitude better. So, you know, like, I could easily see our Granlund eventually being a 20-goal guy in the NHL. He definitely has the shot for that. So how things shake out, again, we have to just wait and see. But everything to this point is a positive. So
I think looking at the team right now and the management of the team, the thing that might, you know, put Granlin lower on the depth chart than Max Reinhardt is his size. Granlin's 5'10", and, you know, Reinhardt is over 6 feet, and knowing Brian Burke and the type of team that he likes, I think that might hurt Granlin a little bit.
Well, the thing is that, to put it another way, is that Granlin actually weighs the same amount as Reinhardt, despite being smaller. So, even though he is a little bit smaller, he's more stocky, and you need that, like, if you're a smaller player, you need to be able to take a hit and not get, you know, Dustin Boyded, you know, flying through the air.
That's a good way to put it.
You need to actually be able to stand up and, you know, not get flung when you get hit. And Granlin seems to have that stockiness that you need. So, who knows? It's one of those things that the talent that the Flames have in their system, the best of those will rise to the top. And it's one of those things that because we have so many guys that are doing so many different things, it's hard to peg, like, which guy is going to fit the niche for what's needed at that point in time.
Yeah, and I think, you know, in some ways you don't need to peg that. I mean, in some ways you can say, okay, we're going to keep a bunch of these guys in the system, and we can call them up or send them down until their waiver eligibility kicks in as we need different guys.
Exactly, and the thing is that the Flames have about 15 NHL-ish caliber prospects that have the potential to become NHL players. So, you know, you're not obviously going to have enough room in the NHL for all of them. So you have to see what guy it works properly for the team.
Well, not just what guy works properly, but the thing we're ignoring in our roundup here over these last couple shows has been the chemistry among players, too. I mean, you know, maybe Granlin makes it because he really has great chemistry with two other guys, and, you know, Reinhardt doesn't. So there's all sorts of little intangibles that we can't even factor in.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, the ones that don't quite hit the mark for us, like if they don't fit chemistry-wise, they're still decent prospects where you could include them in a trade and get decent value for them, because it's not like they're bad players, it's just that we happen to have like 15 good prospects at this point in time, which is almost unheard of in Flames' past 30 years history. So, you know, like, before it was, like...
And I'd rather be in that problem of having three or four guys competing for one roster spot than giving the roster spot to the one guy who sort of kind of earned it because he's the only guy who can put in there.
It's not the days of, oh, gee, we have Eric Nystrom and David Moss. Woo.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, like, where you're pretty much given a spot by default because you're the only guys there.
Pretty much.
Dark days.
Well, that's it for the prospect centerman that we wanted to introduce our listeners to. But the last guy we had on our list is a guy that we're very familiar with as Flames fans this year, but we wanted to include him because he is still a young centerman to go in our roundup, and that's Sean Monahan. The number 6 pick, the highest pick the Flames have ever had last year. He played for the Flames this year 75 games. He was out for 7 games with a bit of an injury around the Olympics, and he had 22 goals, 12 assists for 34 points. And he was a minus 20. What are your thoughts now looking back at the season on Sean Monahan?
Well, he had a very good rookie season. You know, like, he did get hurt before Christmas, and you could tell, like, after he came back that, like, his speed was not quite there. It was a foot injury, I believe. And he was a little bit behind the play because his speed had been affected by it. But once he got past that, it was back to normal. So, it's one of those things where you can almost discount those games as well because he wasn't himself. But, you know, even then, for Flames rookies, he actually had the most goals from a 19-year-old in Flames history, and that includes Jerome Iginla. So, you know, you can't really complain too much when the guy sets a franchise record for a 19-year-old.
Yeah. And has very big shoes to fill to set that record.
So, you know, like, would you have preferred that his assists were higher? Sure. But, you know, when you're playing with a kaleidoscope of different players that are all on a rebuilding team, you know, you're not necessarily going to be put with a bunch of skill that are on your level of game either, so...
I think you just hit the nail on the head there. I've heard a lot of people since the season has ended complaining about Monahan and how well he did, but we got to remember this is a team that finished in the bottom four teams in the league. So he did well with everything considered that he was, you know, battling with this year.
Yeah, like if you look at Nathan MacKinnon, for example, well, he has Duchesne, Landeskog, Stastny, you know, and a bunch of other guys. Monahan had Colborne. You know, like...
Camilleri sometimes.
Yeah, and Berchi sometimes, Hudler sometimes. Like, that's not even on the same page of talent at all.
Well, that's it. Yeah, so, I mean, 34 points on a team that looked like the Flames did this year, I think is a great accomplishment. Yeah,
and, you know, as we get more talent in there, Berchi back, Gaudreau in there, Poirier... Like, that'll create time and space. It's the same kind of problem that Jankowski is having in Providence. Because, like, his two line mates in Providence were terrible this season. So he was basically doing all the work by himself. And Monahan, similarly, was basically doing most of the offense on his line. So, you know... The numbers aren't as sexy as one would hope, but, you know, all things considered, he did good.
I think, too, because of where the Flames ended up, I don't think a lot of people appreciate how much his contribution meant to his team. I think, you know, if people were really paying attention, I think he'd probably be in Calder Trophy contention, because I think a lot of the rookies that did get picked, like the two guys from Tampa Bay, they were on a team that was a better team. I mean, they were in the playoffs, but I don't think their contributions necessarily meant as much to their team as Monahan's did to the Flames this year.
I'm going to disagree with you there. If it wasn't for Andre Palat and Tyler Johnson, I don't think Tampa even makes the playoffs, because when Stamkos went down, they took over his offense pretty much entirely.
But, I mean, there's two of them.
I know, but... I know what you mean. It's just that, like, Tampa wouldn't have made the playoffs, let alone be where they were in the standings, if it wasn't for those two guys. It's just, this was a very good year for Calder candidates. Like, you had Frederik Andersen, who was doing decent in Anaheim. You had Nikushkin, who was doing good in Dallas. Yeah, there could have easily been 7 or 8 guys that would have been normally qualified to be Calder candidates. So, you know, he had a good year.
He did. And I think the biggest thing that I saw about Monahan from the beginning to the end was how he grew as a person and as a public face. When he was here at the beginning of the year, he was awful. Listen to him talk to the media and that sort of thing. I think he realized, with the help of guys like Berkey and Connie in the office mentoring him, that he is the upcoming face of this team, and he really took that upon himself. And if you listen to his exit interview, he's still not as good as somebody like a Jerome Iginla or even a guy like Mark Giordano, but I think he's come a long way with his public persona this year.
He's increasingly getting more boring as it goes on.
Well, but he seems like he can, you know, he can actually talk intelligently now. I mean, he might not be the, you know, at the beginning of the year, he seemed like he had sound bites. He was kind of, you know, chopping stuff up. And so I'm pleased to see that, because I think as a guy who is going to be a face of this team, he's going to have to do the media stuff. So I'm glad to see that he's coming along.
Oh, definitely.
That.
And the more he gets comfortable with it, the better he'll get at it. You know, it's not like he's Jay Bullmeister where it's always awkward. So,
well, I think with a guy like Conroy in The Office, he's got a good mentor there too. Before we sign off tonight, why don't we talk about some of the netminders in the system?
Definitely.
We don't have a lot of them. We've gone through a goalie shuffle this year, as a lot of people know. They kind of thought Rito Barra was going to be that next hot goalie. He was 27, so he wasn't all that young. He got traded. And so the three goalies in the system, why don't we start with the guy we saw the most of this year, and that's Yanni Orchio. What are your thoughts on Orchio?
Kipper light. There's elements of his game that, like, you can tell by looking at him that are still rough edges, and his movements aren't quite as polished as they need to be, but there's enough elements there that, you know, like, he is only 22 or 23, so, you know, even Kipper took till he was 26 and 27 to get everything put together properly, so, you know, if they're patient with him, give him, like, the full season in the minors, wherever that is, and...
Yeah, we keep saying Abbotsford, but we have to remember it's not going to be Abbotsford next year.
I wish for an announcement sooner than later, so I don't keep making that mistake. Get him a lot of repetition on the farm, and, you know, let Ramo see what he can do, plus whatever backup we get. And go from there.
Yeah. Yeah, and Burke said in his exit interview with the media this year that he does not want Orchio sitting on the bench behind Ramo next year. He wants him playing. So we know that he's going to be in the AHL affiliate.
Well, the thing is that Orchio looks like he has the potential to be a decent NHL starting goaltender. So, you know, if he's not going to be starting in the NHL, then it's better for him to get the repetition somewhere instead of, you know, playing 20 games or 30 games.
Yeah. And, you know, I mentioned this earlier in the year when he got called up, but I want to mention again because I think it's really an interesting point is we think now that Orchio looks like he's got NHL potential, but at the beginning of the year, he started in the ECHL. He was assigned to the Aces. He worked his way up from there to the AHL and then his way up to the Flames when there was an injury. So I think seeing that kind of progression in 1 year says a lot about this guy.
And, you know, at the development camp, he was about on par with the walk-on goalies that were there. Like, he was pretty terrible. And,
well, that's why he got an ECHL assignment.
Like, he didn't show up and, like, with the proper focus that he should have. And that's why he went to the ECHL, but, you know, he had better in him than what he had showed to start the year, and that emerged as time went on.
I think he's definitely got some NHL potential, but I don't think he's the guy next year. I think Ramo's got that job locked out next year, pending some crazy UFA move. But I think that's Ramo's job next year, and Orchio's going to be the guy in the AHL playing a crap ton of minutes, and he will be, you know, 2, 3, 4 years down the road, the heir apparent. Yeah,
at least unless John Gillies, you know, usurps the title from him.
That's true. Well, let's talk about Gillies. I know you've been high on Gillies for a while. You talked highly about him in some of our first episodes of the year when you saw him playing at the rookie camp. Gillies is playing in Cornell.
Providence.
Providence, right. So what do you think about Gillies?
He's a big goalie. He's, I think, 6'5". And he's got all the right movements. His style of play is somewhat reminiscent of Luongo. His main weakness is that his lateral movements from side to side are a little on the slow side, but not by a huge amount, because like when he's in his kneeling position and like his back straight, like his shoulder actually comes to the crossbar, so, you know, with a goalie like that, if he can just manage to get a little quicker in his lateral movements, his glove and his blocker are both very good. He just gotta rough out round out the rough edges and, you know, progress, but...
And this guy's played his, you know, whole career, if you will, in the USHL, the high school league, and then Providence. I think that as soon as you get John Gillies working at the pro level with pro goalie coaches, those things will be easy for him to iron out.
Well, at one point earlier in the season, he had some adversity in terms of struggling in his abilities during his playing time. And... you know, that's the key where you see what a goalie has, and he, after like 7 or 8 or 10 games of struggling, he actually began to turn the corner on that and return to his prior level of play, and that to me shows that, yeah, he might struggle here and there, but he can... re-elevate his game and not get completely thrown by it. So,
yeah, well, that's been the downside of how many good goalie prospects. If they look good, but then they, you know, hit a bit of a bump and they just never seem like they can recover. It takes them a whole year to recover from it.
It only took them a month or so. So that's a positive at least.
So, yeah, I think that's definitely shows up good for him. The Flames haven't signed him yet, so I don't know if they plan to keep him at the college level next year, if they're planning to turn him pro.
He said that he's going back to Providence next year, so...
Okay. So that's probably a good thing in the end, simply because then we don't need to try and find a professional home for two goalies, Ordeo and Gillies.
Exactly. And we don't need to rush either guy, and likely what you'll end up seeing is Ramo holding the fort for the next year or two, then Ordeo taking over for him, establishing himself while Gillies starts coming through, and then having a Gillies and Ordeo battle it out for who's the best guy.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that you'll see Ramo kind of have the net as his as we move through this rebuild. And just the team comes out of the rebuild, I think he'll be handing the net over to Ordeo, saying kind of, you're the next generation, you know, this is your net. And yeah, then we'll have Gillies kind of in the AHL as the next heir apparent. And to me, I think that's important. Always have that heir apparent starting goalie in the AHL, even if they don't end up being the next guy. But I think just having that guy that we all think is going to be there, I think it puts pressure on the NHL tandem. I also think it's good for fans to kind of be able to see this is the next, you know, goaltender in our system.
For example, look at how Rommel played at the beginning of the year when he was the guy and Joey McDonald was the backup. Like, they were both terrible. And, like, that's why Barra came in for that month and a half and was the starter. You know, you need that other guy just to push you forward, even if the other guy might stink as well, but, you know, competition breeds success, and if you have...
It does.
...capable comparables, you know, vying for the same job, you know, the better guy will rise to the top, and clearly Ramo did at the end of the season, so...
And as we've all said, if we have too many of some position, we can always move them. Always trade them and get some value
exactly.
That way.
And, like, that's why, like, having 15 good forwards or a surplus of defensemen, whatever, it doesn't matter because you can always get a draft pick or another, like, Ladislav Smead, whatever. It just, you know.
Yeah.
It more... options, the better you have, because then you can do things that you wouldn't normally otherwise.
Well, speaking of Ladislav Smead, why don't we mention the goaltender that a lot of people forget is in our system who came over with him. If everyone remembers back in November, the Flames traded Roman Horak and the goaltender that you really liked, Laurent Brossoit, to the Oilers for Smead and Olivier Waugh.
Well, I didn't really, really, really like Brossoit. I liked him, but not, you know.
Coming out of the prospect camp, you were quite high on him.
I was higher on Gillies.
Were you? Okay.
Yeah. Brossoit was better than Ordeo at that, but Gillies was by far the best.
And now we've got Olivier Waugh, who is not a Flames draft pick, but now in the system. He's played most of the year in Alaska of the ECHL and did move up to the AHL for about 12 games when we brought Ordeo up to the NHL. I haven't honestly seen a lot of Olivier Waugh to be able to comment on him. I can just look at his stats, which really aren't all that impressive. 20 games played, 13 wins, 7 losses. There's not a whole lot to say about this guy besides I think he's got a long way to go if he wants to rise on this depth chart. He's got a lot of competition.
He's basically this year's version of Matt Keatley.
There's a name I haven't heard in a long time.
Yeah, someone that... He's okay, but he needs to take steps forward. And would I bother signing him? Probably not.
I think you probably keep him in the system till Gillies turns pro, and then he's done.
Yeah, I would be more open to signing some European goalie or something.
Yeah, I guess it depends what you can bring over, but looking at what we have right now, I think it's important to have a goaltender at the ECHL level who can spell off the AHL guy if needed.
Yeah. It's one of those things, if you can find somebody with potential elsewhere, go for it. If not, keep them. It's one of those things where if we don't have him on the roster, I don't think it'll be that big of a deal. He's not a bad goalie. It's just there's nothing jumping out at you as, NHL caliber. He might end up going to Europe after, Leland Irving, and figuring things out over there. And coming back later, who knows, but...
I think without Joey McDonald in the system, too, I think he's a reasonable contract to hold. And even if he ends up backing up Ordeo in the AHL affiliate next year, it gives us some options. And I'm always a fan of having young goalies in the system. Even if they don't pan out, I think we need to give him another year to spend a full year in the Flames system.
I can go either way on that. I'm perfectly fine if we keep him or if we go somewhere else.
Yeah, we'll see what the Flames can get come July 1st.
Exactly. It's like some of our other prospects, like Coda Gordon, where if we sign him, great. We don't sign him, great. Who cares?
Well, he's already under contract, so.
I know.
Yeah, let him. I don't think you're going to get anything for him, and he's not worth using a buyout on, so keep him here till the contract expires and let him earn himself a second one.
Oh, I thought he was done at the end of the year for his RFAs.
I thought it was next year. Yeah, no, you're right. His contract is over at the end of this season. Right now he's making $700,000. I believe is his cap average. So if you do re-sign him, I'd re-sign him probably to less than that. No more than that for sure.
Yeah.
But I think, as an RFA, it might be worth even holding his rights for 1 year and let him go to Europe and see what happens. But yeah, if there's a European goalie we want to try out and bring over, I wouldn't be opposed to it. But if not, I'd say give him another contract, re-sign him.
Yeah. There was one goalie that I saw. It was some Finnish goalie that someone mentioned on Calgary Puck that he came over and played his overage year, and he looked somewhat decent. So, there are people out there. It just, it depends. Like everything. You don't know, we're not at the table, so we don't know who's on the table, possible guys on the table.
We also don't know management's thought on some of these guys either. Maybe Brian Burke is very high on Olivier Waugh.
Yeah, exactly. Because we don't have any in the office sources. Mm-hmm. So we, can't exactly tell exactly what they're going to be doing.
Yeah. Well, I think unless there's anything else you want to say about goaltenders, we'll wrap this episode up.
One thing I do want to mention is just a shout out to both Rob Kerr and Charlie Simmer for the good work that they did with Sportsnet. And it's always disappointing to see good people lose their jobs.
Yeah, they were. It was announced, I believe, late last week that they are no longer going to be with Sportsnet.
Yeah. Well, Kerr's going to be moving back to the radio, but, you know, it's always disappointing when you see good people get some adversity thrown their way.
Well, especially a guy like Rob Kerr, who's really been, I think, part of the Flames experience for so long, whether it's on the radio or doing the Flames TV stuff before the games at the Dome. He's, to me, been that voice of the Flames for a couple years now. And I just, to me, him and Peter Marr go with the Flames. I mean, they're the guys that I always think of when I think of the voice of the Flames.
Definitely.
So, yeah, hopefully both Simmer and Kerr land on their feet.
Yeah, well, Kerr, I'm hoping, does well back on the radio with Sportsnet and, you know, perhaps gets another job on TV at some future point. Or something. Anything that, you know, it is beneficial to his career, because he is a good person. So
yeah, and I really think that I think that he's in his element when he is on the radio. I think the TV was a little bit out of his element, so I think he'll do much better moving back to the radio. But we'll see how it goes.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, Matt, I think that's it for this episode. We'll be back in a couple weeks as we start to profile the entry draft. We'll do one episode where we will profile the picks that, or the players that the fans might see us pick with the fourth round pick. And then we'll do another episode where we'll profile the second, third, and fourth rounds. So I'm looking forward to those. Those are always a lot of fun to do.
Yes, and one of the things that I'm going to be doing in the coming weeks is actually doing my own draft preview of, like, my evaluations on all sorts of prospects. So, like, I'm going to try and find as much information as I can on, like, the CSS top 200 and try and get as much out there as possible.
So if you're interested in some of that, interested in brushing up and knowing, you know, who the young faces are that you'll be seeing at the draft this year in Philadelphia, you can go to firesidechat.ca, where we'll have all that information. We'll also, as always, put it out through our Twitter stream, twitter.com, we're at Fireside Podcast, and on Facebook, we're facebook.com/firesidechat. So all of the information that Matt's working on will be there, and as we move towards the draft, we'll have a couple more episodes talking about the young players there. Well, Matt, it's been fun as always, and we'll talk to you soon. Fireside Chat is produced and edited by Dan Stevenson. This show is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license information, visit firesidechat.ca.